Toussaint's local political style was most strikingly on display in his stronghold of Gonaïves, from which he had expelled the Spaniards. He rebuilt the town completely, paving its principal streets, widening its canal, and embellishing its main buildings. After the departure of Governor Lavaux in 1796, Toussaint turned the Gonaïves district into a more or less independent enclave under his political and military command. He ensured that the administration was staffed with loyal and competent men and kept a very close eye on deliberations of the municipal council. He also built a strong and enduring set of connections with wealthy business figures such as Caz, an opulent merchant also known as Gros Caz, who became one of his financial advisors and most dependable envoys. Toussaint established his headquarters in an habitation, or plantation, in the nearby commune of Ennery, leased to him by Madame d'Escahaux, who hailed from one of the most powerful white families in the colony. This legendary site, renowned for its long alleys, fragrant rose gardens, and the splendor of its principal house, was Toussaint's favorite retreat, a secluded spot where he held secret meetings, both with his own agents and with foreign emissaries. A center of military operations, where officers from across Saint-Domingue came to receive their instructions, and a base from which he managed the restoration of the colony's plantations. It was also a court where he organized cultural evenings and social gatherings. He took ineffable pleasure in the performance of music, especially military music, and often called on his trumpeters and drummers to play for him immediately after supper.
The reader can expect to be taken on so many journeys while reading Black Spartacus. Actually, that's kind of what's great about the book, in a way. It's a journey that takes you from enslavement to liberation to prison, right? So it's sort of like this trajectory of a human's experience. You can be taken on a journey through the birth of a new country. You're taken on a journey through the formation of a new state. You're taken on a journey through the ideas that were sort of animating Haiti during the revolutionary period. You're taken on a journey through a series of battles. I mean, it's really a book as you follow Toussaint's life that takes you on so many different journeys along the way.
Toussaint Louverture was, he was born in the French colony of Saint-Domingue, which in today's terms is the state of Haiti. He was born from enslaved parents who were forcibly transported to Saint-Domingue in the first half of the 18th century, and he became the leader of the largest and the most successful revolt of enslaved people in the late 18th century. I knew that Toussaint Louverture was this remarkable figure, and I had read one or two books about him, but I had heard that there may have been quite a lot of archives, personal archives of his, that hadn't been used yet by his biographers. So I spent a little bit of time in the French archives looking for these documents, and then I discovered a real treasure trove, and there is all this enormous amount of material that hasn't been used. And I used all that material to basically try and recapture Toussaint Louverture's voice, because he has a very singular, very powerful, very original voice. And that's really one of the things I tried to do in this biography.
Well, this is a book that is about a single man. So initially I thought, how is this going to be sustainable? It's a biography, but not the kind of biography I'm used to. It's a fascinating journey at individual level, but it's also a fascinating journey in terms of identity, in terms of people looking at, you know, searching for freedom and fighting for their own freedom, but also for the freedom of their people. So I'm still grappling with a few ideas, but also about how freedom actually changed people, how power changed people as well, and how to be a leader, and how he managed to be a leader who was mostly loved, at times loathed, but always respected by many other people.
I mean, I personally enjoyed just learning so much about Toussaint Louverture, this figure who, you know, truthfully, I didn't know very much about. You know, I think he kind of hovers sort of off in the side in a lot of like my education and my sort of reading experience. You know, we learn so much about certain other figures from this period of time in North America and in France. And Toussaint was not someone who I'd been exposed to in huge depth. You know, I'd read C.L.R. James's Black Jacobins and I obviously encountered him there, but like, I really enjoy getting to understand this kind of incredible figure that is Toussaint Louverture. I think part of what made Black Spartacus make it through when other biographies didn't was just that it's kind of an exemplary iteration of the form. It's sort of a perfectly done biography. I mean, in its thoroughness, in its originality, you know, it's got this incredible character at the center of it whose life touches on so many different interesting issues. And it's got such thorough research and it's told so well. I mean, it's really, for being as thorough and kind of detailed as it is, it's nonetheless able to really hold your attention as a reader. And I think those things combined made it stand out above many of the other, you know, truly excellent biographies that we read this year.
What I admire the most is the sheer determination of Sudhir as a researcher, because the huge amount of source material is simply staggering. It's archival material that he had to look at across several continents, several countries, France, the US, Britain, and a huge amount of letters. So this is a work of art, and it took a lot of time, I'm guessing. And also the fact that he manages to weave a narrative that is not only coherent, but incredibly dense and gripping.
You get the sense reading Black Spartacus that Sudhir Hazareesingh did not leave any document that mentions Toussaint Louverture on, you know, several continents unread. And that's like a pretty impressive feat of research to write a biography like this.
It was very exalting to find all these documents, because when you have pieces of paper that are actually by the person that you're writing about, you feel that you're building a special connection with him. And the great thing about Toussaint's papers is that they're very varied. So in the archives, you will find reports, proclamations, official administrative documents of various kinds. And of course, they're very interesting. For a biographer, for one to discover the public side of the person that you're writing about. There are also a huge number of letters and documents that give you a sense of the private man, and that was also extremely interesting to discover. And that was almost like a treasure hunt, because one of the sad things about Toussaint's papers is that they're scattered all over the world. I mean, literally all over the world. So the letters are actually in dozens of different places. And it was quite an adventure tracking them down. And one of the things I think I've succeeded in doing almost is reading every single one of them. So it was really almost a mission that I set myself to do, and I hope to have achieved it so that I could bring back this special voice of Toussaint Louverture.
I think you should read this book, because you're going to come away feeling like you know Toussaint Louverture. You're going to feel like you know him as a charismatic thinker, as a charismatic political leader, as a political philosopher, as a military genius, as a complex and sometimes flawed human being. And he's an amazing person to spend this amount of time with. I also think this book had a lot of resonance. Like, I was reading this book this summer for the first time, and it was during the summer of Black Lives Matter. I think I was reading it actually while the Edward Colston statue was pulled down in Bristol. And it got me thinking about sort of like, who do we remember from that period of time? Like, whose stories are we telling, and whose stories are we memorializing? And Toussaint is someone you I just feel should be understood and should be like thought about and should be remembered in a way that I feel like he hasn't fully been.